I was invited to talk about the Wuming Foundation, which isn't exactly the Wuming Collective, because the Wuming Collective is a band of authors. Wuming Foundation is a more vast and manifold and multifarious subjectivity that developed from our blog, JAP, and the discussions of our books. But before talking about the Wuming Foundation and the kind of work that we do, the kind of condividual that we're building, to use the categories that are being used in this two-day conference, I have to talk a little bit about the Luther Blissett project. Yesterday, we talked already about the Luther Blissett project, and to us, to Marco and me, it's ancient history, but there are things that must be said, stories that must be told before talking about the Wuming Foundation, because the main subject of my presentation will be the legacy of Luther Blissett's psychic wars in the Wuming Foundation. And I'll provide a few examples of this. But before doing this, I have to explain what psychic warfare was in the Luther Blissett project. So there are two different subjectivities here. The multiple use name Luther Blissett, whose use started in 1994, and the name is still being used. There were some recent media hoaxes, one concerning Harry Potter, for example, that were signed as Luther Blissett, and the Luther Blissett Project, which was a more organized network within the network of people using the multiple use name. It was a five-year plan and lasted from 1994 to 1999. Members of the Luther Blissett Project committed a seppuku, a Japanese ritual suicide, of course, metaphorical, because I'm still here, and stopped using the name. We didn't prevent anyone else from keep using it, but we moved to something else. The best account of the Luther Blissett Project is precisely the chapter devoted to Luther Blissett in Marco's book, Improper Names, which I recommend. I'd say it's the best, which means it's less incomplete, because it's very difficult to tell all the stories related to the use of the multiple names in Luther Blissett and the activities of the Luther Blissett Project. But it's 50 pages long. The chapter is 50 pages long, very, very funny, very entertaining. It is very rare to find such an entertaining chapter in an academic book. So I congratulate Marco for that. There was a practice that was very common in the Luther Blissett Project. It was the psychic attack. It was kind of a telekinetic attack. This is a leaflet that was distributed in Rome in the fall of 1995 with instructions on how to perform a psychic attack. You know, that you can see the little guy standing with legs wide and directing a flux of psychic evil energy against a target. This is it's part of a cartoon that was distributed as well in those days. The psychic attack, we're meant to channel negative energy against a political enemy, against cultural targets, very often against projects of invasive mega infrastructures. That's what we did, especially in Bologna, while in Rome we chose other kinds of targets, and Marco talks a lot about that in his book. Okay, for example, in January 1995, we decided to perform a psychic attack against the project of a colossal high-speed railway station that was meant to be built in Bologna. It was signed by a very famous Catalan architect, Ricardo Bofill. It was gigantic. It would have had a big impact on the life of the city. It costed a lot of public money. We decided to perform a psychic attack against the project. The attack was broadcast live on two local free radio stations, the two radio stations that broadcast our radio show, the night radio show that was called Radio Blissett. Two nights later, there was a happy coincidence, because in Barcelona, fire broke in Bofill's studio. And this is the article from El País, the biggest Spanish newspaper, reporting the event. It happened only 2 days after our psychic attack, so of course we claimed responsibility for it, because the plastic, the project of the station, was burnt in the fire. And that station was never built, because in 1999 they withdrew the project. Okay, so it was a big success of our psychic warfare. After the seppuku, there were many offshoots of Luther Blissett. Okay, these are the most visible and famous ones: Wu Ming, Eva and Franco Mattes, guerillamarketing.it. And there was a kind of strange offshoot several years later in Sweden, in Stockholm. There were many other offshoots that were less visible, sometimes single persons were offshoots of the Luther Blissett project, individual projects, but all of a sudden, from 2011 to 2013, in Stockholm, people started performing psychic attacks against political targets. This is a video of one of these attacks that was performed in 2011.
Welcome, you're watching the Psychic Warfare Chronicles.
Idag genomfördes den första psykiska attacken. Målet var att störa installationen av Sverigedemokraterna i riksdagen. Då alldeles för höga värden uppmättes under Voight-Kampf-testet kunde vi av säkerhetsskäl inte attackera med vår fulla styrka på 2093 psykiska soldater. Trots detta uppnåddes så höga amplituder på Psychic Energy Amplification-systemet att attacken nödgades avbrytas när tre fönsterramar lossnade från riksdagshuset på grund av de kraftiga skakningar som den utsattes för. Det är med glädje och stolthet som vi ger er denna första rapport från det psykiska slagfältet.
These people also published a journal called the Psychic Warfare Bulletin. You can find the, you know, the PDFs of all the issues online. And strangely enough, I found this newspaper in the hands of Dario Argento. Okay. And then we come to the Wu Ming Foundation, Wu Ming's work, about 20 years later. The Wu Ming Foundation is a kind of collective of collectives, or condividual of condividuals, if you prefer. There are inquiry groups, laboratories of collective writing, cultural projects of all kinds, which were mainly born during discussions on our blog, JAP, and very often people started to collaborate after long and dense discussions on our books, not our novels. It was more frequent to see this phenomenon when our other books came out, for example, these ones, Point Lenana, Timira, or Asce di Guerra. Those are the books that we call unidentified narrative objects. They're not exactly novel. They are, to put it simply, non-fiction written with narrative techniques, but it's a... this description doesn't give the idea. It's too simple, very wild, very hybrid narratives. Our blog started in 2010 and was kind of a new beginning of our project. Before that, we used to send an email newsletter, also named JAP, after the Vietnamese general Vong Nguyen JAP. But in 2010, we decided to start a blog, which has become a laboratory of experiments, collective inquiries, investigative journalism in a way, collaborative writing, and this had an influence on our work as writers. There's a constant interchange between what we write in the Wu Ming Collective and the activities of the Wu Ming Foundation. Our books affect the work of the Wu Ming Foundation, and the work of the Wu Ming Foundation keeps influencing our work. And one of the collectives that developed from our blog is Nicoletta Burbaki. Yesterday we talked about Nicolas Burbaki, and of course this is a kind of a tribute, a transgender tribute to Nicolas Burbaki. In 2012, during a discussion on fascism and the legacy of fascism and on our blog, some people decided to get together in order to carry out an inquiry, do an inquiry on far-right manipulation of the pages of Italian Wikipedia, which is a big problem in Italy because hundreds of Wikipedia pages were polluted during the years by fascists, especially pages of related to our national history. You can find the Italian equivalent of Holocaust denial on the Italian Wikipedia, because there's denial of chemical warfare, fascist chemical warfare in Ethiopia. There's a denial of Italian war crimes in Africa and in the Balkans. This group got together in order to fight on Wikipedia, to do an inquiry, but also to change the situation in Wikipedia. The group expanded during the years. Now it comprises historians, researchers in various disciplines, sociologists, for example, writers, because we ourselves are part of Nicoletta Burbaki, and activists of various kinds. It's a collective pseudonym. I registered the difference between multiple use name and collective pseudonym that Marco does in his book and did yesterday in his talk, because the use of the pseudonym is controlled by the collective. It's not a multiple use name that can pop up everywhere. It strongly identifies this kind of activity. The woman in the avatar in the pic is Albert Einstein's wife, Serbian physicist Mileva Maric. This is one of the pictures that we used in order to the fight on Wikipedia. You know, who will be the first to take Wikipedia? And the mainstream media started to cover the activities of Nicoletta Burbaki, because some articles were published. La Stampa is one of the biggest Italian newspapers, and this they are reporting some of the things that Nicoletta wrote during the years. Another part, an important part of the Wuming Foundation are the Wuming Labs. They're not exactly writing courses. It's more or less a traveling factory, because there are Wuming Labs all over Italy. It's a kind of a laboratory in which we try to understand how and when a narrative becomes toxic. That's a concept that we use, toxic narrative, narrazione tossica. And we try to deconstruct toxic narratives, disassemble them, analyze them, and rewrite them in order to find a new way of telling that story. There have been Wuming Labs on several issues, on environmental issues, for example, on history issues, Wuming Labs for kids, Wuming Labs that were also trekking walks, and new collectives were born from this activity. One of them, for example, Metalmente, is entirely composed of factory workers, and they write stories about working class life, and they recently published a book called Meccanoscript, a collection of short stories about the condition of the Italian working class. Okay. And this is a picture of a Wuming Lab that took place recently about environmental issues. In fact, there's a NOTAV flag. Another important collective that is part of the Wuming Foundation is Alpinismo Molotov, Molotov Mountaineering. It was born in 2014 out of the discussions on two of our books, Il Sentiero degli Dei by Wuming Tzu and Point Lenana by me and Roberto Santachiara. It's a collective of antifa, anti-capitalist mountaineers. They want to develop a critical approach to mountaineering, to mountain sports, and to all those practices that are related to the mountain, but that are often plagued with superomism, you know, machismo, nationalism, even fascism, competitiveness and commercialization. Alpinismo Molotov is also part of the NOTAV movement, and recently they held their first national three-day festival in Susa Valley, not accidentally, in a social center in Avigliana, a social center that is strongly identified with the NOTAV movement in Susa Valley. Okay, this is was one of the trekking walks during the festival. You see NOTAV flags and Alpinismo Molotov red flags with the bottle and the mountain in the bottle. Another aspect of the Wuming Foundation is a musical activity. We also have a band, a punk rock band called the Wuming Contingent, that already issued two albums, and now they're working on the third one, which is about the history of electroshock therapy in lunatic asylums. And also we have many collaborative projects with musicians, DJs and rappers, and other kind of performing artists. That's an activity that we cherish we've been doing it since the very beginning. This is the cover of one of the albums of the Ming contingent, Scheggia di Shrapnel, Splinters of Shrapnel. This is a gig of the Ming contingent in VAG 61, which is an occupied social center in Bologna. And there's the quinto tipo, which means fifth kind, and the references to ufology. It's close encounters of the fifth kind, are those kind of close encounters with alien objects in which we establish a conversation from the distance. You send a message and they send a response to the message, so you establish a conversation. That's a close encounter of the fifth kind. In 2014, we started Quinto Tipo, Fifth Kind, which is a series of books edited by yours truly. This project started from our conversation that we kept having with readers about this thing of the unidentified narrative objects. We decided to build yet another laboratory and a place in which this kind of nonfiction with literary techniques could be published. We published 9 books, and now we are editing the 10th one, which is the book of an international volunteer, an Italian who went to Rojava to fight against ISIS, to fight against Daesh with the YPG. And the book is called Hevalen, which means comrades in Kurdish. And the subtitle is Why I Went to Fight ISIS in Syria. The guy is called Davide Grasso, and we're editing his book. And these are covers of some of the books that we published as Quinto Tipo. And then there's this very intriguing project of which Wuming is part, is called the Resistenza in Cirenaica, Resistance in Cirenaica. There's a neighborhood in the eastern periphery of Bologna called Cirenaica, like the eastern region of Libya. It was built in 1913, just a year after Italy had conquered Libya. It was a kind of a way of celebrating Italian colonialism, the conquest of Libya, the invasion of Libya, calling this neighborhood Cirenaica. And all the streets had colonial names, via Tripoli, via Benghazi, and crap like that. In 1949, the left-wing administration of Bologna decided to change those names and replace them with names of fallen partisans, anti-fascist fighters. But the name of the neighborhood is still Cirenaica. Resistenza in Cirenaica is a federation of collectives, cultural associations, social centers like VAG 61. And we took the double name of the streets and the name of the neighborhood as an opportunity to tell suppressed stories about Italian war crimes, Italian colonialism, the legacy of fascism, all those things that are not usually part of the mainstream national discourse in Italy. So we organize urban trekking walks in important places of the resistance in the neighborhood. We research the history of the neighborhood. We paint murals. For example, this guy, the logo of Resistenza in Cirenaica is the face of Omar al-Mukhtar, who was the most important commander of the Libyan resistance against the Italian invasion. And we cherish his memory very much, and we are planning to paint a big mural in the neighborhood with his face, which will expose us to the accusation of being traitors of our fatherland, because he was a murderer of Italians. And that's great. Okay. For example, this is the last stop of one of our trekking walks in the neighborhood. Here we are in Via Libia, the only street that kept the old colonial name, Via Libia, Libia Street, and we just changed the name by putting a new placard with the name of a woman, Vinka Kitarovic, who was a Croatian woman who was deported in Bologna and managed to escape from prison, joined the Bolognese partisans and fought the resistance in Bologna. Okay, and we changed the name in Via Libia from below, unofficially, of course, in Via Vinka Kitarovic. And then there's this another offshoot, another collective. The AIST is the Associazione Italiana Studi Tolkieniani, Italian Association of Tolkien Studies, because there's this weird phenomenon in Italy. During the 70s, fascists appropriated The Lord of the Rings, The Hobbit, Tolkien books, and Tolkien-related imagery. Because the left ignored all that stuff, the right appropriated. For example, neo-fascist festivals were held called the Campi Hobbit, Hobbit camps. Of course, it was a misappropriation because Tolkien was a conservative guy who wasn't a fascist in any way. But this situation remained unchanged and unchallenged for decades until Wumingfor decided to work on that, to do research on how Tolkien's literature had been hijacked by fascists. He debunked their interpretations. He wrote several pieces, essays, and a book called Defending Middle-earth, and then co-founded AIST. And now AIST is curating the new revised Italian edition of The Lord of the Rings. So we're also involved in Tolkien studies. Okay, and now the examples of the legacy, you know, the heritage of psychic warfare in the Wuming Foundation. Psychic warfare took new forms in the Wuming Foundation. For example, rituals of defascistization. That's what Alpinismo Molotov does. This is very amusing because when fascist mountain clubs, quite a few of them in Italy, when neo-fascist mountain clubs go to the peak of a mountain, they reach the peak and they open their banner and the flags, we go there and decontaminate the place. For example, this is particularly awful. 3 years ago, a gang of Italian members of Casa Pound, there's a neo-fascist party, raised an Italian flag, a tricolor, you can see it there, on top of Mount Učka in Croatia, and opened a banner with the text Blutum Boden of Italy, Terra e Sangue d'Italia. It was a hateful gesture. You may wonder why these people are upside down. That's because we celebrate the Italian tradition of hanging fascists upside down, like it happened to Mussolini himself. This is a playful take on the subject. This is cut out the Duce silhouette and hang it according to old partisan tradition. I did it. It's in my house. I have it. Yeah. Okay. So Alpinismo Molotov in March 2015 decided to go on Mount Učka and perform a ritual of decontamination. Okay. They went there. They staged a parody of Casa Pound's ascent to the peak. They wore pig masks and they made fascist salutes, that kind of stuff. And then when they reached the peak, they performed the ritual, which consisted in a collective reading of material on Italian war crimes in Yugoslavia, in former Yugoslavia, and also, very important, the multinational resistance in this land, because many Italians deserted the Regio Esercito, the army, in 1943 and joined the resistance. And also many Italian-speaking civilians joined the resistance. It was a multicultural, multinational resistance, and Alpinismo Molotov celebrated it on top of Mount Učka, and they also raised an Ottav flag in order to join the resistance on the western border of Italy and resistance on right beyond the eastern border. Okay, and then there's this other Antifa thing called the Abyssinian Curse or Effetto Graziani. In August 2012, in Afile, which is a small town in Latium, the region where Rome is, a right-wing mayor decided to dedicate a mausoleum to Rodolfo Graziani. Rodolfo Graziani was one of the worst fascist war criminals in Italian history. He was viceroy of Ethiopia after the fascist occupation. There was a turmoil around this inauguration. You see, it's very ugly building, very, very ugly. There's Fatherland Honor. There's some celebrating material in there. There's a portrait of Graziani. It's a very ugly and depressing place. And it looks very much like a typical Italian public toilet, which you call Vespasiano, public urinals in the street. They're called Vespasiani, and it more or less looks like Vespasiano. That's why in Bologna some people dedicated urinals to Graziani. And they replaced honor with odor. Okay. But I don't want to talk about this. I want to talk about our operation. Our operation consisted in constructing a narrative on Rodolfo Graziani being a jinx, a guy who brings bad luck. As we say here, it's not exactly critical theory, it's not historical materialism, but it works because people believe this kind of shit in Italy. We don't believe in jinxes, but fascists do. And reality helped us because right after the inauguration of the mausoleum, the Latium right wing was invested by a wave of terrible scandals with people arrested, the top leaders arrested. The governor of the Latium region was a fascist, Renata Polverini, had to resign, swept away by the scandals. And the right wing mayor of Rome, Gianni Alemanno, even stated that a dark curse waves on Latium. You say, of course. Of course, you inaugurated a mausoleum dedicated to Graziani. Even Alessandra Mussolini, who is the granddaughter of Il Duce, also a right-wing politician, fell into a street sinkhole with her car. Of course, we made fun of her and we said it was a foiba, of course, no? And then Alemanno's apartment was robbed by anonymous with a lowercase a, but maybe, who knows, maybe with a capital A, in broad daylight. And we say this is all a consequence of the fact that you inaugurated this mausoleum because Graziani was notoriously a jinx. He brings bad luck. We even wrote it in Slovene. I don't know how you pronounce that. Anyway, it's Graziani brings bad luck for the people who don't read Slovene here. Also, terrible things happened in Filettino in the following period. I mean, there was the sewers broke in Filettino, which is Graziani's hometown, and evil shit polluted the local river. And there was a big fire that destroyed the forests around Filettino. Then there was a snowstorm that caused a huge blackout. And this was all a consequence of the fact that Graziani was a jinx, because when he was the governor of Ethiopia, he had all the magicians, sorcerers, fortune tellers of Addis Ababa killed, because he thought they were making propaganda against the Italian occupation. And so he sent carabinieri out to kill any sorcerer, fortune teller. So we invented that this attracted bad luck on him, and he became a jinx. Okay, it's not historical materialism, it's not critical theory, it's not Marxism, but it works. And then this Tifiamo Asteroide. Tifiamo Asteroide was another psychic attack in disguise, and the whole presentation, We Want the Asteroid, is titled after this. Because in June 2013, center-right and center-left in Italy formed a coalition government, and so we decided to perform a psychic attack on this coalition government of left and right together, left with inverted commas, right and right together. And so we decided to launch this project, which was Tifiamo Asteroide, We Support the Asteroid, in which we invited people to imagine a big meteor or a small asteroid killing the prime minister, Enrico Letta. So we sent out a call for short stories. All the stories had to belong to the science fiction genre, and they had to depict the destruction of the government, of the prime minister, by a falling asteroid. And then with these lines, the only guideline, the only rule, was this, that all the short stories had to end like this. After the deafening roar, with our ears ringing, we could still hear that music. There, where up to a moment before, Enrico Letta, leader of the large Entente coalition government, was standing, was now an incredible chasm. Clouds of black smoke were rising from the huge crater. And hundreds of stories poured in, and we chose 100 of them, and the e-book was an incredible success. It was a free e-book, freely downloadable from JAP. It was downloaded tens of thousands of times in the first week, and since then, on the Italian Twitter, Tifiamo Asteroide, We Support the Asteroid, has become a classic. It's being used every day when you're fed up with something, when you see a politician doing something that gets you very much annoyed and enraged and frustrated. And so on, you say Tifiamo Asteroide. And in fact, an asteroid fell on the little government because it lasted only a few months and was replaced by another government, the Renzi government, the government where Matteo Renzi was the prime minister. As I brought here, it looked more or less like the same shit, but in fact was even worse. And so we decided to perform another psychic attack, Renzi Scappa, which means Renzi runs away. Because what happened during the Renzi government was that Renzi's visits, Renzi's official visits to Italian towns were met with growing resistance and protests and riots. It happened dozens of times from 2014 to 2016. It kept happening, but the media didn't connect the dots. They treated every protest and every riot against Renzi's visits as an isolated fact instead of trying to, you know, find a narrative in there. So we decided to launch a hashtag, Renzi Scappa, Renzi runs away, Renzi flees, in order to give a name to this practice and even provided some technical tools to monitor the phenomenon. But yes, it is, if you look for Renzi contestato a, which means protest against Renzi in, the suggestion, YouTube suggestion, Renzi in Florence, in Catania, in Treviso, in Naples, in Palermo, in L'Aquila, in Matera, in Thirst, in everywhere, everywhere. Because it happened everywhere. So this is an interactive map. The biggest dots are the cities where it happened more than one time. It happened in Naples many times, you know, and there are also the kind of who were doing the protests. There's a lot of useful data here. This is another tool. It's a story map. It's kind of a web doc, a story map, in the sense that every major protest is covered with a description, a narrative, videos, and stuff like that. Well, the national media started to talk about this initiative, Renzi Scappa. This was the first map, but then it was covered with dots. What happened was that the Renzi government fell because it lost an important referendum last December. And this is another thing that we did when the people started saying that by attacking the center-left, you're helping the right. Wrong. Because we showed that the Democratic Party, the center-left party, had many responsibility in the growth of the far-right in Italy. And even we ran an investigation that is still going on with contributions from many people of documented relationship between PD leaders and far-right groups. And also because that's what we think happened. Okay, this is a scheme. You know, if you vote for the lesser evil, for example, if you vote for the Democratic Party in Italy, that's what happens, that the center becomes the left, then the right becomes the left, then the far right becomes the left, and everything moves ever more to the right. So, okay. Those were a few examples of psychic warfare. What is psychic warfare nowadays in the Mumin Foundation? Psychic warfare is a floating signifier because it doesn't point to any precise doctrine or theory. You know, everything can be psychic warfare. The floating signifier becomes a perlocutionary narrative. You know, a perlocutionary narrative is a perlocutionary utterance in linguistics, is an utterance that is described from the point of view of the effects that the utterance has on the other people. Okay, so it's a perlocutionary narrative because it generates effects. Describing a practice as psychic warfare triggers strategical concatenation of individual inputs. And I find this category of individual and condividual very useful because each one of us is a individual nowadays online. We leave traces of our transactions everywhere, and those traces are parts of our individual activity. Online, we are not individual, also because we have many personalities and we are involved in a continual multitasking activity. We leave pieces of our activity, of our actions everywhere. We are individuals. Some of these pieces, some of these traces are organized in these projects that we launch, that the Women Foundation keeps launching. They become concatenations of little actions that become individual projects. And each concatenation expands the set of tactics and practices that give agency to this big condividual of condividuals that we call the Women Foundation. Thank you very much.